talking about the second part of the amylogenesis class. So first class, what have we read? Which group it belongs? How the mechanism was? So we'll just brush up and go further. So amylogenesis discovered by Waksman. Okay, these were the group of antibiotics which are acting on the protein synthesis, and they have a specific structure where there is aminoacetyl ring. Okay, so this aminoacetyl ring is there, and two amino sugars, they are bonded by the deoxystreptamine. Okay, so in case of streptomycin, it stands outside, but in case of all other aminonucleotides, it is in between. So two units of this amino sugars, we call them as streptobiosamine. So where we have to start with mycin, and where we have to start with MICIN. Okay, so we should be particular. So this is based on the origin. Okay, so MICIN with this amino acid, gentamicin and natamycin. So we have both systemic and topical aminoglycosides. Okay, so in systemic, the streptomycin, which is used for tuberculosis, we have amikacin and gentamicin, most commonly used for urinary tract infection. We have some of the reserve drugs such as natamycin, topamycin, okay, and topical, most commonly used neomycin, carmycin, which are more toxic or severely toxic for systemic use. So properties, highly ionized. Okay, then you need to remember excreted unchanged in urine, that's why more renal toxic, they are bactericidal, and the cross-switch system is part is there. That means if it is drug is resistant to, if the bacteria is resistant to one, there can always be cross resistance. So ototoxicity, nephrotoxicity, narrow margin of safety, okay, and they are highly soluble in blood, in water. So post antibiotic effect, this is what it makes the aminoglycosides more useful, post antibiotic effect and concentration dependent effect, based on which, even though they have the shorter half life, we can use them as a single dose. Mechanism of action, we discussed that it is by action on protein synthesis, irreversible protein synthesis inhibition, that too acting on the 30S ribosome. So you saw these things. After the protein synthesis block, there was false incorporation and the protein synthesis mechanism was obstructed. So here we can see that what are bactericidal, what are bacteriostatic. So we discussed them. Here you can see bactericidal, under bactericidal we have the antibiotics, okay, which are beta lactams, vancomycins, and which are cell wall synthesis inhibitors. We have quinolones, rifampin, and metronidazole. Okay, so here this side we have chloramphenicol, erythromycin, clindamycin, sulfonamides, and tetracyclines. Tetracyclines, though they are from PTS, they are bactericidal. So you need to remember the drugs acting on the TS and PTS. So just remember DUT, aminoglycosides, tetracyclines. Or rest all others are the 50S. So resistance, either the drug cannot be made penetrable, or anaerobic infection is created, or resistance to the site where the aminoglycoside can bind. Okay, and also synthesis of the metabolic enzymes which can metabolize our aminoglycosides, that is acetyltransferase, phosphotransferase, and adenine transferase. So pharmacokinetics, we learned that there is no tablet of this amylopectin available because high energy compounds given by IMAT, intramuscular route, intravenous route, and absorption is increased on site of inflammation, and they are not used in pregnancies. The plasma protein binding is minimal, that is, most of the drug what we give can be seen at the site of the action. So, penetration of the CNS is less, that means they cannot be given systemically for the CNS use, but they can be administered locally, that means they can be administered intrathecally. Okay. So, we will be learning it today. So, CNS penetration is less, 10-25%. So, direct concentration after systemic administration cannot be seen in the CNS, CSF and the intraocular fluid. So, one more distribution, it is decreased in leukemias, and the drug can be removed by peritoneal and chemodialysis in case of toxicity. So, antimicrobial spectrum, it is gram negative, bacteria, okay, E. coli, Shigella, Pseudomonas, and Enterococcus. They are less effective against anaerobic organisms. So, therapeutic drug monitoring, this was necessary because the drug is more toxic, and once the drug is more toxic, we need to maintain the plasma concentration. Why you need to administer such toxic drug? Because in the antimicrobial diagram, we can find that sometimes it is the only drug which is possibly helpful in such a patient. So, streptomycin, the first drug which is used in tuberculosis, we already learned this. Okay, so it is the oldest antibiotic, older antibiotic. It is low the organisms such as Leprae, Brucella, Leucardia, Klebsiella infernalis, most of them are susceptible. We use it only for the tuberculosis. So the dose is here. You can see 15 to 25 milligram per kg body weight, slightly higher dose. So chances of minor toxicity are more. So, uses are tuberculosis, some of the bacterial endocarditis, plague, urinary tract infection, peritonitis, and septicemias. Coming to the next drug, that is gentamicin. Okay, this is the most commonly used drug among this group, gentamicin, amikacin, most commonly used drug. So, we will be comparing the rest of the drugs compared to gentamicin, whether the toxicity or the effectivity. Okay, whether it is more effective than gentamicin or less effective than gentamicin, or it is more toxic or the spectrum is more than gentamicin as such. Okay, it is obtained from Micromonas spora. It is more potent drug than streptomycin. So, broader spectrum of activity here, Pseudomonas is important, Proteus, E. coli, and Klebsiella. So, we know that these are the organisms which can be the main targets in urinary tract infection. These are the most common drugs which common bacteria which can cause urinary tract infections. So they are not effective against Mycobacterium tuberculosis, streptococcus, and pneumonia. So this drug cannot be used with tuberculosis. You will get the slide. Okay, so dose is calculated based on the body weight. Usually we give the dose of 1 to 2 milligram per kg body weight, but sometimes up to 3 milligram it is used. 3 milligram per kg body weight, it comes around maximum 100 milligram per day. Okay, so the cost is very less, that's why it can be more commonly used among our population. Okay, and reliable efficacy. And we need to remember, other than the case of this urinary tract infection, the concentration attained at the site of infection will be comparatively less. But when used along with the cephalosporin or penicillin group of drug, it will be more helpful. Here you can see it is used in tract infection, pneumonia, which is nosocomial. What is nosocomial? Okay, so peritonitis, meningitis, and in sepsis. Okay, why it is now near again meningitis? We know that the CSF concentration is less. Okay, just think of it, we will be coming to it. So it's used to be restricted to serious gram-negative bacterial infections. In respiratory tract infection, as I told, the concentration action attempt may be lesser, but when used along with penicillin or cephalosporin, it is helpful. It is having good penetration in the site of infection, because one negative point here is good penetration into the alveoli and also at low pH. This drug should enter the bacterial cells through pouring channels by passive diffusion. Okay, this passive diffusion is based on the electrochemical gradient, which is maintained there. But once there is low pH, this electrochemical gradient, which is required for the drug transfer through this pouring channels, may be disturbed. So at that point, just gentamicin, to be simple, this gentamicin will not be as a single agent in treating the respiratory tract infections, severe respiratory or low respiratory tract infection, but when used along with the penicillin or cephalosporin, that will be helpful. And once if it is used as a single agent, then it always helps for rapid development of resistance. Okay, so it is used in combination in treatment of endocarditis for strepto, staphylo, and enterococci. So the plasma concentration and the dose is somewhat similar. 1 mg per kg body weight, and the plasma level we expect it to be around 1 to 3 micrograms per ml. So topical use is there. That means a gentamicin solution can be made and used for infected burns, skin lesions where the purulent exudate is as present. So intrathecal administration for meningitis caused by gram-negative bacteria. So coming to the next drug. So antibacterial spectrum of clobramycin, it is somewhat similar to our gentamicin, but the dose here is little bit more. It was 1 to 3, here it is 5 to 6. And in case of lower respiratory tract infection by Pseudomonas, in cystic fibrosis, it is used by inhalational drug. Okay. So there are very few antibiotics which are used by inhalational drug. Remember one word. Antiviral drug, any antiviral drug, what of your curiosity to read more of newspapers, any area, antibiotics given by inhalational drug. Other than steroids and bronchodilators, any drugs? Have you heard of calcitonin? Salmon calcitonin? Calcitonin, where it can be given? What is the reaction? Yeah? What is calcitonin? Yes. Where it can be given? One is calcitonin and another one is for dreaded flu. Recently you were thinking. What is Tamiflu? Have you heard of Oseltamivir for influenza? That is Tamiflu. And Zanamivir, which is inhalational antiviral agent.
And here?
We are using this agent, clobramycin, inhalational solution for lower respiratory tract infection in case of cystic fibrosis with lower respiratory tract infection. So nephrotoxicity is less compared to gentamicin. So omeprazole, again, it is comparatively more potent than our gentamicin, less toxic, semi-synthetic, derived of over kanamycin. So resistance in enzyme that inactivate gentamicin and rosomycin. That is very important because in case we have this cross resistance also, here the drug is resistant. That means it is active in the cases where the patient has already become resistant with the basic gentamicin. So widest spectrum of activity uses same as gentamicin, but it is used most commonly in cases where respiratory tract infections and urinary tract infections along with parkeracillin. Tazobactam is the drug which is given for the second pyelonephritis. Along with that, they use the amikacin in BD dosage, 500 mg. So here the dose is 15 mg per kg body weight, that means approximately 500 mg, 2 times daily is given intravenously. And one more positive point about this drug is it is used in multi-drug resistance TB, resistant to streptomycin. Okay, so MDR TB is more than usual normal dosage, normal regimen will be for maximum of 6 to 9 months. Here in the case of MDR, we go up to 24 months treatment. So it is also a result of hospital acquired gram-negative bacillary infections. Cysomycin, identical to gentamicin, is more potent for pseudomonas and beta-hemolytic streptococci and can be used similar to gentamicin. So metillimycin, okay, it is not commonly used drug because it is a reserve drug for us. Okay, so the important point here is it has additional ethyl group. Okay, something like the clobramycin, it was resistant to the enzyme generated against gentamicin. Okay, here it has additional ethyl group which protects it from enzymatic degradation. So that is one positive point, that means it can act for longer time. So lowest toxicity, that is one more point, and this is a sensitive purity of cysomycin, more effective against Klebsiella, Enterobacter and Staphylococci. The negative point here is it is less active against Pseudomonas. So doses and pharmacokinetics similar to our gentamicin. It is used in cases of lower respiratory tract infection, UTI, septicemia, peritonitis and endometritis. Neomycin, kanamycin and paromycin. These three drugs fall under the same mechanism group. Okay? Neomycin, these are systemically very toxic drugs. So most commonly we use them for our topical use. So wide spectrum of activity against gram-negative bacilli and some gram-positive cocci. Pseudomonas and streptococcus pyogenes are not sensitive and they are used topically for skin, eye, external ear infections, and they are provided bacitracin and polymycin B, two widely used antibacterial drugs. Okay, they are used in the form of solutions, 1 to 5 mg per ml is used for clearing the surfaces. How many, when you clear this pleural cavities? There can be a pleural infection along with a pneumonia also. Okay, so they can occur together or sometimes they can occur in isolated. This point I am telling you was in case of tuberculosis, we have pulmonary tuberculosis and extrapulmonary tuberculosis. Okay, in case of this pleural infections, sometimes maybe due to this tuberculosis also, we treat them as an extrapulmonary and the regimen follows the similar way. So they can be used to clear the joint cavities also. So there can be local instillation of the antibiotics in case of arthritis due to infection.
Okay.
Osteoarthritis and some tissue spaces and abscess cavities. Local instillation is possible. As these are very toxic drug, we are using them for local activity. So these are more nephrotoxic drugs, and in general,
okay,
in preparation of bowel surgery,
okay.
So it is also considered as a local treatment,
okay.
Preparation of bowel surgery is 1 to 3 times daily, along with the erythromycin paste they are using. What is erythromycin? Which group? It's not a. Have you heard of azithromycin? Which group? So it is not among the drugs which are learned. What will be the next group? Okay. So in case of hepatic encephalopathy, what is happening? The ammonia concentration, if it is increasing, there can be more problems.
In case of hepatic
encephalopathy, we have to prevent the coliform bacteria which is releasing more ammonia.
Okay,
so we need to decrease the consumption of the drugs which can cause this ammonia release, and also we can decrease the protein intake, and along with that we can suppress the coliform flora also. Okay, all these three mechanisms along with use of lactulose, they are helpful in preventing this worsening of this hepatic encephalopathy. So 1 gram systolic is given there, and it is used for bladder irrigation. Maybe you have done some surgeries where you have to remove the stone or any external some additional growth. Okay, there we need to irrigate the bladder before or after surgeries. So paracetamol, we told that its action is somewhat similar to our neomycin. Okay, so property similar to neomycin, effective against visceral leishmaniasis. Okay, we have a particular separate of drugs which are that separate topic will be taken, where we will be learning about this anti-amoebic drugs and anti-amoebic drugs. But some of the antibacterial drugs also have that used there. They are effective against this visceral leishmaniasis by paracetamol. So it is used for intestinal infection, treatment of hepatic encephalopathy, and also for amoebiasis. So carbamazepine, one more topical drug, very similar to neomycin. It can be used topically for irrigation purpose. Most commonly it is available in the form of ointments. Okay, for used topically for skin and eye, ear or ear infections. So coming to the adverse effect part, we learned that it is most neurotoxic, nephrotoxic and neuromuscular blockade, and also some neurotoxicity is also in this drug. So ototoxicity, vestibular and cochlear part is affected, and it is concentrated in the labyrinthine fluid. So this toxicity will be more when the plasma concentration goes above the minimum inhibitory concentration, or the concentration something like for gentamicin is 1 to 5 and for amikacin not more than 25 micrograms, like that. So what will happen when the concentration increases, vestibular and cochlear sensory cells get destructive changes. Once they are destructive, they can cause permanent ear loss, hearing loss. But if it is, you are sensing that ear toxicity at the earlier level, that is reversible. Once the drug is stopped, it is reversible, but not at later stage when we are given the drug for longer duration. So nephrotoxic, it is in case with more elderly patients where the changes have taken place. For example, the person is already under diabetic nephropathy and renal parameters have decreased. Okay, something like we need to maintain the creatinine clearance. Okay, like the renal parameter to understand whether the renal function is normal or not is the creatinine clearance. Okay, so we need to see the cranial clearance before administration of these drugs. So damage is reversible if the drug is discontinued at earlier phase, and it has been suggested it also interfere with the prostaglandin production, and also there is decrease in the GFR. So the kidney has its function by excretion of the fluids is prostaglandin mediated. Okay. So once this prostaglandin synthesis is inhibited, what happens? The GFR or the glomerular filtration rate can also decrease. So neuromuscular blockade, okay, on our other side, what can they do? They can decrease the release, okay, release the acetylcholine release from the motor nerve endings. So they have something like Curare-like action. Curare means D-bupropionate. What they do? They can paralyze the for temporarily. Okay, this is a relaxant, but temporarily they can paralyze the person. That's how they used to hunt the animals previously. Okay, you might have seen those diagrams. So Curare-like effect is there, and it can cause the paralysis and fatal respiratory arrest. Okay, that one is the better thing. You need to be careful. And you can go for kidney also, and can be treated with neurostimulant. Neurotoxic effects, optic neuritis, peripheral neuritis, angioedema, these are very rare. Okay, eosinophilia and blood dyscharia with a later group of drugs. Blood disturbances are seen with this later group, neuromuscular, medial muscle, those groups. So contraindication, we are avoiding it in pregnancies because of prototoxic and nephrotoxicity, myasthenia gravis because of neuromuscular blockade action, renal impairment avoid because it decreases the GFR, which is mediated in prostaglandins, Parkinson's disease, again we are avoiding it. Ear drops are contraindicated if there is hearing deafness, and tinnitus will also be seen when the drug is used and can disappear once the drug is discontinued. So we already know that here we are leaving two groups of drugs together. One is penicillin or cephalosporin along with our aminoglycosides. The negative point is if they are used concurrently, okay, for example we are using a gentamicin injection, then again our penicillin injection, they can inactivate each other. Okay, there should be a fair amount of interval period when they are given. Okay, so ethacrynic acid, what is it? Series is over. Diuretics, do you remember? Okay, it is also a diuretic. Okay, loop diuretics, they can interact with and their action will be altered. Nephrotoxic agents, if they are combined, okay, can you name other nephrotoxic agents which you might have learned in any other class? The most dreaded ones are amikacin B, antifungal drugs. Okay, so neuromuscular blocking agents, you may already have gone through complete classification. These drugs should not be used together. So streptomycin, this is a glitterly newer drug. Okay, it has aminocyclic trajectory but lacks the aminoid inverse on the glycoside bond. So it is something like a newer aminoid glycoside. Okay, so it is given for drug resistant gonorrhea or penicillin resistant gonorrhea by intramuscular route. Okay, it is nephrotoxic and anemia can also occur with this drug. Dosage is relatively high, 40 mg per kg.